Alright.
Close enough to 10 o'clock.
Yeah, I'm sure people will trickle in.
Good morning, Shmoocon! So hopefully you all enjoyed the party last night. And since you're here at 10 o'clock for the first talk, you're not too hungover, so that's good. New announcements. Please send feedback to feedback@shmoocon.org. Whether you have feedback about the party, about the speakers, about the registration, about the vendors that we have here, about the contest, whatever feedback you have, we'll make sure it gets to the right people. Something we really do care about is trying to make Shmoocon a better place to learn and experience and to make this community better. And one of the best ways to do that is for you to let us know what you think. And we do actually make changes based on the feedback that you provide. So please, feedback@shmoocon.org. And again, we still have t-shirts that are available. These are for donation. We make no money on them. We buy the t-shirts ourselves. And your $15 goes directly to charity. We make zero profit from that. We take none of that money and use it for buying t-shirts. All of it goes directly to charity. So please check that out. And with that, I'm going to throw some stuff into the audience.
I should probably put my ball bag down first. So you all know the deal with the ball. We talked about it before. If you think this speaker is saying something wrong, let him know with the smooth ball upside the head.
Yes.
However, if you do fire at him, feel free to fire back. Hopefully you're paying attention. A pre-solved Rubik's Cube, Shmoocon Rubik's Cube. This one will hurt if you're not awake. So, a nice pen with a nice cover from one of our sponsors, Grim. Okay. And holy crap!
First time.
All right.
So if you want more moose, you have to come to more talks. All right. With that, I have no more things to say, and you'd probably like to get on to the actual talk that you're here to see. So please give a warm Sunday morning welcome to Patrick, who's going to be talking about running slices of binary code with inside of Python.
All right, let's get started. I have quite a few slides, so I'm going to try moving quickly. Thank you all for coming. And yeah, before I talk about ripr, I'm going to introduce myself really quickly. So my name is Patrick Biernat. As of like a week and a half ago, I'm a graduate of RPI, and thank you. It's great to be done with school. I'm a member of RPI Sec and have been for about 4 years or so, and I tend to lean towards exploitation and reverse engineering during CTFs and such. So a few words about. I had a job, but yeah. So RPI Sec, who are you, what do we do? We're the CTF team and computer security club at RPI. We focus on competition and education. So obviously we play tons of CTFs, and I recommend you do too if you want to get better at security. And as far as education goes, we hold multiple weekly meetings to teach RPI students how to do security work, kind of teach things that won't really fall into the normal curriculum. And whenever we can get away with it, we teach semester-long classes on hard and interesting security topics. So MBE, which you might have seen on GitHub, and malware analysis are the two big ones we try to run as often as we can. And I think the newest iteration is actually starting like in a day or two. So yeah, definitely watch the GitHub for updates. And last note, definitely RPI is like the coolest thing I've ever had the privilege to be a part of. So yeah, if you don't have a CTF team, you want to get better at security, I highly recommend getting into that kind of, into that community, or building one if it doesn't exist wherever you are. Okay, so right before we get into the kind of technical details of ripr, I kind of want to paint a picture of what motivated me to create this project and why it might be useful. So as most of you know, if you're in this room, right, binary reverse engineering is the art of mapping tons of low-level details into some kind of abstract, high-level meaning. So you start off with a ton of assembly, if you're lucky, organized into a nice control flow graph. And from this, you're trying to analyze it, you're trying to understand what it's doing, and you're trying to get something like this, where, okay, I know this giant, ugly block of code is basically just generating a prime number. So why do we do this, right? There's some purpose, generally, not just reversing for the fun of it. Vulnerability research, right? Can I write some exploits for whatever code I'm interested in writing exploits for? Malware analysis, can I figure out if some piece of code is malicious? What's it doing? Is there something I can use to detect it? Interoperation, I want to make my thing work with some other thing, and I need to figure out how that other thing works so that I can build mine on top of it. And so, at least at RPISec, frequently in the context of CTFs, we run into this kind of situation fairly often, where we've done all the work, we understand more or less what the program is doing, and we come to a point where we just need to take some functionality from a particular binary, implement it in our solution script, in our exploit script, and we think that once we do that part, then we'll be done, and we'll get the flag, the exploit will work, et cetera. And so inevitably, when you hear these words, I just need to implement this, and we got it, we're done. This kind of comes up shortly after. You know, give me 5 more minutes, this works sometimes. I'm gonna single step through GDB and check every single value to figure out what's going wrong and where. And the takeaway from that, right, is that re-implementing code can be pretty difficult. First off, maybe the most important thing is that this isn't the fun or interesting part of reverse engineering. You've done the interesting work of ripping apart your binary, figuring out what it does. You've more or less solved the puzzle, and now you need to dig through this kind of long process of actually re-implementing code and getting it all to work nicely together. On top of that, it's very bug-prone, you know, and this just single basic block, when you're re-implementing stuff, maybe you missed that left shift by 3 somewhere up in there. And that's not so terrible until you get into large functions and it takes you a half hour to figure out exactly which one you missed and where. All these kind of factors combine into the fact that this can turn into something that takes a long time and isn't very fun. So wouldn't it be great, right, if we saw this long, complicated function inside of some disassembler and could just right-click it, say package, and then from, for example, Python, say, okay, let's just run this, and then we get the exact functionality from that block of code. And that's essentially the kind of rundown of what ripr tries to do. So when is this relevant outside of just CTFs? There's just a few kind of examples. Vulnerability research, maybe you want to quickly run through a function with a bunch of different inputs and see if you can get some particular state to happen. Maybe you have some ARM code or some kernel code and you don't really want to set up a full testing environment. You're only interested in 1 or 2 functions. So with something like this, right, you would be able to just quickly run that particular thing and see what's going on. Malware analysis, similar kinds of stuff. Kind of confirm what this function does. If there is maybe some custom encryption or custom encoding, do I really need to rewrite it? It'd be great if I could just kind of rip it out of the binary and use it from my own code. And of course, exactness. Sometimes you do want, you know, the exact same behavior as the original code with the same bugs and architectural quirks. So that's kind of the big picture of what I want to accomplish with this tool. And the next, probably the most of the rest of the slides are going to talk about how ripr actually works and kind of give some anecdotes about how we're figuring stuff out as we go along. So at a high level, we can think about what do we need to accomplish this goal, right? So we can split this up into two big things. We need a way to actually run code from a bunch of different architectures. And we also need a way to figure out what data or other code the code that we're interested in depends on. So more concrete terms, right? We need a good emulator and we need a good disassembler. So Unicorn Engine and Binder Ninja fit these two criteria very well. So if you haven't heard of either one of these, I'll do a quick introduction. So Unicorn Engine is a lightweight, multi-platform, multi-architecture CPU emulator framework. Although this doesn't quite do it justice, if you want to think about it in the simplest terms, you can kind of think about it as a KEMU that you can script and interact with from a wide variety of other languages. So Binder Ninja is a modern reverse engineering framework. So I'm sure lots of people here have worked with IDA, maybe Radari too. It's along those same lines, but it has some other nice features that make it particularly well-suited to this kind of project. And so specifically, we have our disassembler, which is great. That's the bare bones minimum that we need. The UI is nice, so that's good too. The most interesting thing about it, actually, though, is that all the analysis that it does is based on an IL. So rather than kind of going with architecture-specific analyses and stuff, it lifts your code to an intermediate language that you can access and does analysis on that. And so that's nice because any analysis you write, you don't need to really worry about, okay, is this x86 specific? Is this x86-64 specific? Is this ARM specific? For the most part, you write your analysis once and it will work. The API is clean and it's actively developed. So yeah, that's the rundown for Binder Ninja. So let's talk a little bit about the design and implementation of ripr. Keeping in mind the dream of just being able to right-click on code and then use it from Python as quickly and accurately as possible. So from the high level, what do we need to do, right? We need to create this environment within the emulator that has the code and has a stack. Those are pretty much the absolute bare minimum things we need. On top of that, we need to find everything that this code might depend on and make sure that all that stuff is within the emulator state so that our code works as expected. And then additionally, right, if we can make this output somewhat nice to use, that's great. Design goals, these are design aspirations, really, but yeah, it'd be nice to abstract away most of the back-end dependencies, so we try to write things in a modular way. Clear boundaries on functionality between all the different components. If something breaks, you can very quickly see, okay, this is where it's breaking, this is what I need to fix. Third one is especially important. You're doing all this analysis, trying to figure out what pieces of code, what pieces of data, this is the code you're interested in, depend on. It's really important to kind of give users a way to see what your tool sees intuitively. So if it doesn't work 100% of the time, which it won't, you can instantly identify what you need to tweak in order to get it to work. And so these are kind of four conceptual components of the tool that we'll probably go through fairly quickly. The four there, packager, code analysis, analysis engine, and code gen sort of work together in order to produce your final output, which will be a Python class that encapsulates the functionality that you've selected. So analysis engine is just a abstraction over a static analysis backend. So we have that. It's implemented for Binder Ninja currently, but really you could just subclass that and write it for the IDA Pro API or Radari 2 or any other static analysis backend that gives you a API to work with. Moving on to packager. Packager is the thing that's in the driver's seat. So all the high-level behavior, go take this code, run these analyses, are all defined in there. And once we have basically gotten all the information that we can and enough to make a valid output, we trigger code gen, which actually does that part of the process. A few words on code analysis that we'll get into quite a bit more later. This is essentially the component that's responsible for finding all of the dependencies of your code and also running a few convenience passes when applicable. So, like we said before, it basically runs, it tries to find all the dependencies, and by having all this code here, it's, again, nice and segregated. So, finally, CodeGen is actually responsible for creating that valid Python class that it gets, using all the information that it gets from the packager. And up until that point, it basically acts as a container for all the information about the particular piece of code that we're interested in. So all the pages that we figured out that we have to map are stored in there, all the code and other data that we need in order for this to work stored there. Obviously methods for emitting valid Python code, and then also things to set up a set up Unicorn for whatever specific architecture you are trying to rip out. And so this also has the nice benefit of being able to probably fairly easily support any languages that Unicorn supports, mostly by changing string constants and maybe a few other things depending on the language and all the emitter methods inside of CodeGen. So hopefully that gives a little bit of context once we start talking about actually setting up the execution environment, and that's what we'll get into now. And so again, let's go back and think about the absolute bare bones minimum that we need to successfully emulate our code. So we need the actual code we want to emulate, right? And we need a stack. The stack is the absolute simplest part. You just map some memory and throw the stack pointer somewhere within it. But actually getting the code looks like this, which is a little bit more complicated, still pretty simple. You want to grab all the basic blocks that belong to that target code or to your function. All the ones that are contiguous, you want to put into a unit. You want to map all those units and mark the last one so you know when to potentially stop emulating. This strategy kind of comes from the way the binary ninja API is structured, but it's also kind of an observation into the fact that functions don't necessarily need to be contiguous in memory, but they often are. So this kind of catches both of those cases. So another thing to think about if you're sort of following along. So what happens when you reach the end of some function that you're packaging, right? You hit a return statement, and since we've sort of started execution in the middle, there isn't any more kind of program context for it to correctly return back into. We need a way to signal that, okay, the function has ended successfully, and this is everything has gone well. So return guards are kind of how we solve this. Basically, before we start emulating, we set up the environment such that when we crash, because we will, that we will crash at a particular marker value. And then if we crash, we can detect that. And so we see, OK, we've crashed, but it's at our marker value. So we know that our function has executed successfully. So for example, set the return address to 0x1 or some other number. And if we crash and we're at that number, then we know that we've gone through the entire function. So are we done? Obviously not, but this is the core of the emulator state. With just this, you kind of have a bare bones, minimally viable kind of plugin that you could probably write within a few hours. With the main problem being that you're limited to really only emulating or ripping out functions that are purely logic functions. They don't depend on any other data. They don't depend on any other code. They do a bunch of operations and return a number. So this is already pretty useful for things like hash functions, maybe some crypto functions. But it'd be great if we could, out of the box, support a wider range of things. And so a large part of that comes from the dependency resolution process inside of ripr. And so reiterating again, what are dependencies? Any code and any data that our target code can access or execute during a normal execution. So more concretely, this might be things like global variables, things in the .data, .ro data sections, jump or call targets not within the original scope. So if you're, you know, you're calling a function and it calls another function inside your code, well, if you don't also grab that other function, then your first function won't work right. So we need to make sure we grab as many of these as possible, because missing any of them will most likely result in incorrect or even worse, behavior that works but works not quite correctly. So this is a pretty important part of the whole process. And so there are three strategies that are used to actually find as many of these as we can. So simple data scan is basically we're just taking all the analysis that Binary Ninja has done and taking everything that we need from that that is relevant to our code. So we run through all the strings, all the symbols, all the constants that Binary Ninja has identified, and we take the relevant ones and make sure that they are mapped appropriately in the emulator state. Data scan goes a little bit further and actually uses the LLIL to look for things that we might have missed. So for example, if there's a like a memory write or a store instruction to a particular piece of memory, that might not get picked up as a string or a constant or anything by Binary Ninja out of the box, but we can use LLIL to say, okay, we need to make sure this memory is mapped so that this write won't crash the emulator. And then branch scan, that's where we look for call and jump targets that our target code might jump to. And so these are the two data strategies that we talked about, and you end up with a list of data dependency objects. But so if you've ever done any kind of this work, you can sort of imagine that you can't necessarily tell with 100% certainty what data exactly will be touched using only static analysis. Imagine a for loop based on user input or a random number that starts reading and you can't really tell until runtime exactly what it's going to do. So we only get a base or starting address most of the time. And so kind of this kind of, you know, heuristically, there's two strategies we can use to address this and most of the time end up with a pretty successful package of a particular piece of code. So section mapping and page mapping. Section mapping is super simple, and this is really all you need to say about it. If we touch a particular section in the binary, for example, .data, .ro data, let's just take that whole section and put it in the package and hope that whatever was using that data will not read outside of it. Page mapping is similar in spirit, but essentially applied to pages. So we go through the binary statically, and we look at all the pages that it might touch. And for all those unique pages, we make sure to include all of their data inside of our package. So the default is a section mapping mode. So in practice, it gives you pretty good reliability. For the most part, it will grab all the stuff that, all the data and variables that your code needs. And you won't accidentally map things like the got or PLT. And this is important when we talk later about resolving imported functions, because we are actually expecting those to crash so we can catch them correctly. But if we map them and they're just a bunch of zeros and we jump into them, we are going to execute basically until we hit some unmapped page or even worse, some other instructions, and this will mess up your entire execution. So a few words about branch scan. Also fairly simple conceptually. Basically, we go through the IL, and every time we see a jump or a call or a go-to, we check if that we have already mapped that code that it points to. So if it is, we've already mapped it, great, we'll just keep going. Otherwise, we add it to a dependency list. And then for all the dependencies that we found, obviously, we want to put all of them into our emulator state. And then we have to run the dependency finding code against them. So often these functions, maybe they call other functions, or they use some data that the original function doesn't use. And then if we find any new code dependencies through this process, we repeat until we don't have any more dependencies to explore. So a few words about convenience passes, I guess. Most of these aren't actually, or weren't actually super useful, so most of them were actually kind of removed. But there are a few, and I kind of wanted to give the idea behind them kind of for completeness sake. So a good way to describe these is analysis that we don't necessarily need. Specifically, that means we're not looking for dependencies with these passes. Rather, what we're doing is we're trying to create a more convenient interface to this package or this emulator state that we've created. So return value extraction is one that will pretty much always work and will never break anything. So it's a good example to talk about. For example, in 64-bit Linux code, RAX will be the register that the return value of your function is stored. So rather than have your package run and then have the user have to explicitly read out RAX and then use it, we can just kind of detect that this is how the code is structured, and we can just return RAX at the end. Unimplemented, but also kind of gets the idea across of convenience passes, is, for example, you could take that, and then if you have type information available from Binary Ninja or from our own analysis, we can actually return like a relevant type. If we know it's a char star, we might just return the string that the char star points to. So that's kind of the big picture of how ripr works, a quick rundown of the major components. And so in this section, we're going to talk a little bit about limitations and how some of them are addressed or handled. So they come down to one thing, right? You can't really emulate what you don't have access to. So the most common examples, imported functions, imported data, and syscalls. Imported functions, as probably you're mostly familiar with, are functions typically part of a library that are loaded into the address space sometime during runtime. And so most commonly during program loading, but not necessarily. On Windows, you can always do like load library. On Linux, there's other ways to load in libraries at runtime. And the general idea is this. You have your program in memory. It's getting loaded. And it's, OK, I need some libc functions. And your operating system or loader will say, great, I found this one on disk. Let me map it into your address space. And now your program can use functions like puts or printf or malloc, et cetera. So the implication here, though, is that most of the time, we won't even have access to the library or the specific library that the program expects. Imagine you're looking at a ARM binary on Linux or a Windows kernel driver on Linux or Mac OS. So you won't really have access to that code to rip out, even if you wanted to. And so there's two strategies that we can sort of use to deal with this. One of them is hook and replace, and the other one is just get rid of the calls, which is fairly often actually an OK solution. So hook and replace is definitely a more interesting and useful one. And the basic idea is to let these calls to these important functions crash the emulator. If we catch that, jump into a Python hook, and then restore context and keep going. So these are the kinds of situations that we are really concerned with here, where we're calling puts or some other libc function. Obviously, we don't have access to that. It's not inside our binary, but we would still like to be able to emulate this function. And so in a little bit more detail, this is kind of how that process works. So the first thing we need to do is to build a map or a record of expected return addresses to our imported functions. And we can build this statically during packaging. So it's nice we don't have to do it at runtime. And specifically, what we'd be doing here is, for example, taking the address of move EAX0 at the end there as our expected return address and mapping that to the puts function. So then when we crash, we need to recover the return address on x86 or x64. We can look at the stack on ARM. We can look at the link register, et cetera. We can check that against the map that we created in step one and call the corresponding Python hook that CodeGen will generate. Once we've done that and you've done whatever you want to do in your hook, we do required cleanup for whatever particular architecture that we're running on, and we start emulating again back at the expected return address. So what can you do from these? Pretty much anything that you need to do to either re-implement functionality or do other things that might be useful. You have full access to the emulator state. All of the Unicorn APIs are exposed in these hooks. So any data that the original binary would have access to, you also potentially you do have access to. And you can also do things like add or remove unicorn hooks. So maybe you're interested in tracing code or doing some instrumentation after a particular call to a particular library. So you can do that from these hooks as well and use all of Unicorn's cool features that probably don't have much time to get into. Knocking out calls is the other strategy. Super simple, does exactly what you think. In plenty of cases, this is an acceptable solution if, for example, you just have some functions that print stuff or log stuff or just sleep. You're not interested in them, you can just knock them out and they'll work fine. This is maybe particularly useful in cases where you want to run your package code in a very tight loop, like if you're trying to brute force a particular value. If you're constantly jumping in and out of Python to hook your functions, that definitely slows things down. So those kinds of scenarios, you probably just want to knock out the entire call. So system calls are kind of a limitation for the same underlying reason. You have this kind of scenario where you have a user space binary along with a bunch of libraries that make system calls to the kernel in order to perform some task. And so the issue is, right, that you perform your syscall, you hit a syscall table or some dispatch method, and from there, you branch out execution all over the kernel. This takes up a vast amount of code, obviously. So the implication is that if we wanted to automatically emulate all these things, we'd have to emulate huge portions of all applicable kernels, which is pretty much impossible, or at the very least, very inefficient. And another point, right, is that syscalls typically do things that maybe don't make much sense in an environment where that's being emulated. So if you want to read or write to files, there's no files because it's just a very minimal emulator. There's no file descriptors. Networking doesn't make sense because there's no networking hardware. There's no concept of a network. For executing programs, there's no operating system. There's no scheduler. There's no file system. It's not necessarily something that makes sense to do. So when you come across system calls in a package like this, you can use Unicorn hooks to actually hook them if you really do need to kind of slide in some functionality. But for the most part, they aren't really supported or really needed most of the time. Okay, so that's the main things that I wanted to talk about. And I have a few demos that I wanted to run through. Hopefully they all work. So yeah, this should give you guys a better understanding, kind of a better picture of exactly what ripr does. So I'll minimize this. OK. So in here, I have a few files. Hopefully you can read that. And let's take a look at main.c. So you can see it's a pretty simple program. All it does is it calls func1, which prints that it's inside there, and then it returns func2 plus func3, which just do some simple math. So if we run this, you see that expected. We have our three printing functions, and at the very end, it prints the answer that the first function returns. So if we look inside of demo.py, this will not work right now because these three imports don't exist yet. We're going to create them using ripr. And then once we create those files, we subclass them. We overwrite the hook puts function to actually kind of simulate what puts would do. So we read the argument and print out the string. And then we print what the actual value that the function returns is. So we do that for 64-bit, x86, and ARM. So we start Binary Ninja here. So plugin is loaded right now. We're inside function 1. So I'm going to right-click, hit package function. Let's see, name this x86 test. So we found, it's telling us that we found calls to imported functions. So we're going to hook them so that we can actually use our subclass hook puts methods. And now it's saying that it's found other code in the binary that our function depends on. So we're going to say, yes, we want to include that. And it's saying, great, we also found some data that we need to get this thing to run correctly. And we will use section marking mode for this. So this is the kind of output that ripr will actually generate. It's a Python class that basically takes all the code and data that your code is dependent on and wraps it up in a unicorn state. You can see the hook puts function, all the hook functions by default will just do nothing and return back into your emulation. And so that's why we subclassed and overwrote it. Another thing I kind of wanted to point out is when you run ripr, it will take all the basic blocks that it's collected and give them a sort of black background as opposed to some of these other functions. So you can sort of visually know, okay, this is everything that ripr found and identified. All dependencies that it finds will be highlighted in yellow, so you can also instantly tell, okay, it found all these things and mapped them automatically for me, and then it marks imported calls in a red highlight, so you can also kind of instantly visually see everything that ripr sees, and kind of if there's some complicated code, if something failed, you can quickly tell, okay, it didn't catch this thing, I need to go back and add it in. So with that, I'm going to grab the other two packages that we need. And again, I'm going to hook calls, grab that, and we're going to use section marking mode. And for the last one, for arm, we'll do the same thing. Going to hook calls, yes. All right, so now we have these three packages, and we just need to save them so that our demo will work. Okay. Should save it as .py. Okay, so we have those three packages ripped out. And now we can run our demo. Okay, so right off the bat, we've started with x86 64-bit. As you see, we caught the calls to puts, which crashed the emulator, but we recovered that, jumped into our hook code, grabbed the argument, and printed out what the normal binary would have printed out. And then at the end, we can see the answer is also 15, as in the original binary. So I think next we're going to do x86. And again, it worked correctly. We took the same kind of process and outputted all the same values. And for ARM, same thing. So that's a quick demo of the actual hooking and packaging of code with ripr. Let's see, I do have one more demo that is maybe a little bit better for contextualizing the tool and showing where it will be, where it could be useful for you as a reverse engineer. Oops. So, if you're familiar with the flare challenges created by FireEye, this is a Windows kernel driver that was, I believe, one of the last challenges 2 years ago, or for 2015 at least. And this is a particularly interesting example because, first off, it's a Windows kernel driver. You don't see that very often in CTFs and such. And the other thing is that it has a ton of highly obfuscated, pretty sort of complex code embedded in it. On top of that, if you kind of reverse through this enough, you'll eventually see some functions that look like they're doing crypto. This one in particular, if you're familiar with a T encryption algorithm, if you would Google search these constants, for example, you can tell that it's doing crypto, and then it's doing a bunch of calculations with pretty obfuscated code. So as a reverse engineer, your options for tackling this are either trying to statically reverse these functions and understand exactly what they're doing, or setting up a full Windows debugging environment, which is a long, difficult process. So with ripr, we can, for example, if we're interested in what this function returns, we can just try packing it really quick. And there we go. We can try to run it and see what it would do. So we have to instantiate the class and see what it actually returns. Okay, so it returns something. Another reason that I chose this example over a few others in particular is that it's fairly easy to check with another feature of Binary Ninja that isn't really related to what I did, but it's easy to confirm that things are working correctly. So can show level IL and then check the register state. And if we look down here at the end, right, AL and AH are 2D and 7.1 respectively, which is the same thing that we have actually gotten from our package code. So we've essentially taken kernel driver code written for Windows XP, I believe, and packaged it as a Python class and then ran it from a 64-bit Linux instance on Python. So rather than having to do the whole reverse engineering process, in many cases you can just rip out your code and use it however you need to use it. So that is mostly all that I have for today. I wanted to thank a few people, if it was possible. So Professor Jenner was my advisor. It's kind of a non-standard project to do for a master's thesis, but he sort of let me run with it and gave me a whole bunch of good ideas along the way. RPI Psych, of course, that I've talked about already, and the Shmoocon staff and sponsors who always take a big risk with letting a new speaker come up and talk about their work. So with that, that is the actual end. I think we probably have a few minutes for questions. If I don't have time to get to, I'll be around the con for all day, essentially, or you can talk to me on any of these places. So yeah, the code is essentially done. I need to basically clean up the repo, move it over, and make it public. So take that in the next few hours. And with that, I'll take any questions. Okay, so if you have any, I guess just raise your hands if you have anything. Yeah, are you talking about school debug?
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, so School Debug lets you use Unicorn as a debugger inside of IDA, but you won't be able to use that code's functionality from within your own code. So you can like step through it using Unicorn, but you won't be able to write your own code and then jump into a binary function. Yep. All right, I don't think there's any more questions, so feel free to come down and chat if you want to chat, and thank you very much.